evidence of the early noughties. Yes, the early noughties. So we were just, I was just having a little catch up with Tatu actually. So all these photographs are from London nightlife in the sort of the window of 2003 to about 2006, we feel. Yes, you remember it well. To me, it's all a blur. Anyway, I'm going to hand you over to Tatu, who is going to explain their more recent projects, all very exciting, including drag witches, aliens. What else is it?
Drag queens, aliens, and queer witches.
Very exciting.
Thank you, Julia.
Thank you.
Okay, this is the slideshow that will continue after the lecture talk part. And Mikko Karhu, Mikko Ko, who has been a part of this London fun and still is playing after, and then this slideshow continues. But I will put a stop for this now and do another slideshow. I will be clicking to next one. So welcome everyone. My name is Tatu Vuolteenaho, and this lecture is called Drag Queens, Aliens, and Queer Witches. And it's about talking about my history. How have I become to feel like queer witches is the next thing to do? And there is you can see that there is already the starting page on this art project, the queerwitchproject.com, and my personal website is tatuvuolteenaho.com. And if you have, if you want to communicate with me, easy is email tatu-art is, or what is that line art@hotmail.com. And this first image is a self-portrait, because I will be doing paintings of queer witches, so I practiced with a self-portrait, so when the project is done, I could have many of these kind of paintings. And I will first start with defining what I mean by queer witches. Queers, I guess everyone knows, so it's all gay, lesbian, bi, trans, questioning, all people. And it's slightly more radical or questioning or progressive than just like regular gays. Like, queers don't want just to copy the heteros, they want to challenge even some basic forms in our society. But I'm not a queer theorician, but some people have said that I have done queer stuff in real life, so I guess I can do that. And witches, I decided to take a definition from that time where there were witch hunts, and then it was basically anything that was different from the mainstream religious beliefs. So even, you know, if you were doing plant medicines or making some kind of rituals or whatever that the church didn't accept, then you were called witch. And from that point of view, nowadays, even yoga teachers would be witches. So in my definition is very broad. Everyone who does anything with magic or spirituality could be, for this project, a witch. And And both those words, queer and witch, have been used as words of abuse, like, you know, queer is odd and strange, and witch, if you tell someone is a witch, it might mean that's kind of really bad or scary person, but we can say that we are queer witches, and that's a good thing. And how I would do this project is that I will, well, I already know many queer witches, and I will talk with them, meet with them, and do some rituals or magic or tarot card readings or whatever to get to know more about their magic. And then I will photograph them and paste the paintings on the photographs. And I hope that some of this magic will actually be on the final paintings. So that will be interesting to see if some other dimensions can be channeled into two-dimensional paintings. And one more thing that, because there are lots of different like isms, or there is occultism or New Age or whatever, paganism. Only criteria for me is that I want this to be a good project about good ideas, happy feelings, love, peace, this kind of stuff. I mean, I won't go into promoting animal sacrifices and stuff, but even I have met some people who claim to be Satanists, and they seem to be nice and clever people, and I haven't figured out yet what they actually do, but I don't see that, you know, some so-called dark sides are that dark. But, you know, if you do something good for yourself or others or nature, then you can be part of this project. And so I start with my childhood. I was born in Finland. This is my first day at school, going to school. I was fashion model by then already. And so, because in this lecture, we are also given the possibility that maybe reincarnation could be possible. And someone might even decide in their state before they are born that this would be the good place for them to learn the lessons they need to learn. Or I could be just lucky that I was born in Finland, because it's like one of those countries where there's good system, like if you are poor or if you have difficulties, then the government systems help you, and then you don't have that much stress and problems. And also I was lucky because, well, the family is quite basic or normal, like, and my mom is still very healthy and good mom, so, and she was a school teacher, so I got that. And in Finland, the school teachers even get one of the best educations, and so I got like very good starting point. And then when I started to grow up, I was actually thinking that women are sort of better role models, like this one, Alexis Carrington, A Dynasty by John Collins. And I wasn't so keen to copy the male role models. And early on, I got introduced to this kind of esoteric knowledge of paranormal things, because my mother's second cousin, Rauni-Leena Luukanen, later she married and she's Rauni-Leena Luukanen Gilde, she wrote in 1982 a book called There Is No Death, Kuolema Ei Ole. So then it was very exciting to learn about all these paranormal things. And then part of the book she had channeled from her grandma that had died already, all these universal love messages. And then she has written many books, but then this other one, Tähti ja Lähettiläs, is like messenger from the stars. She did the whole book by channeling extraterrestrial beings, and all the messages there. I read it like in the 90s, and again a couple of weeks ago when I was in Finland, and all these things that I've been investigating, and messages and ideas, they are all already there. Like, you know, 30 years ago, she was. And it was about like how we can save the planet and, you know, be nice to everyone and equality and all these things that some more advanced civilizations in some other galaxies already are like that, and they don't have wars or other things that are so last millennium. And then I went to United States, and I was an exchange student. And then we were at some junior ball, and we decided to go three there and do the traditional couple thing. And we had this goth look. And then this is actually the one who was in the picture, Chrissy. I met her again. She was in Valencia when I was there in Spain, DJing. How many years ago? And now I have one video to show, which is like part of this era of like finding youth styles. And this is Visage Fade to Grey, and Princess Julia is on this one also. And she helped me to get this gig here. And I was like admiring all these styles when I was a teenager, and then I came to London later and I got to meet many of these people. The sound.
Oh.
This was not in the rehearsal of modern technology. Well, maybe most of you have seen this video already, and it's in YouTube, and it's really good, and it's inspirational. So, we are not going to be watching that. Let's see.
Thank you.
okay, here I'm like 18 or 19. I graduated from high school. I guess that's the same as A levels. And then I went to New York, and I was like daytime dressing up as if going to party all the time. And that was good because then I met the right people. I met Cindy in New York, and Cindy knew all the drag queens and fabulous people, and she was like getting me dresses and lipsticks and telling, try this on. And then we had fun and went out. And then I actually became a club kid in New York because Michael Alex said that, come to my party dress like that and we pay you. So I was then working at the Disco 2000 and other parties. And here is years later with Cindy. Cindy died from a brain tumor. She was already on some heavy medication, but it was good to give her some joy and happiness with this freaky fun drag that we used to do. And for now, let's see if the internet works again, if I can show another video. Well, it looks like I can't have internet now. I mean, I had it before, but we'll have to do without the video clips, I think. Okay, back to the video. And here's some artwork from Cindy. This was in Dancing Beat magazine. And I also made hats and studied photography, so there's some of that. And then some of the contact sheets. Yeah, me and Cindy organized the parties, pre-parties with lots of fun, fabulous people, and I got many pictures of RuPaul too. And there is Mona Food and Bahoma. And this is through all now. And here I'm with Billy Beyond. And since I couldn't show the video clip, I can tell about Sister Dimension and Billy Beyond. Even their names sound like they are quite multi-dimensional intergalactic beings, and those were inspirational drag for me. Here I looked quite nice and pretty, and sometimes some men thought I was a real girl, and so I have learned to see from that point of view that if men think that I'm a real woman, how they treat me. And then I took pictures of these club kids. And then there were flyers made with these pictures. And I made paintings. And this is like how I started my art career, was in New York. I did decorations, paintings of club kids for Disco 2000 at Limelight. And there was my ex-boss, Michael Alec. And Kabuki Star Sign. She's a famous makeup artist now. And we even had the factory party at the Limelight. And I was Andy Warhol, and other club pictures where people were different club personalities, factory personalities. And then me and Nina Kulmala, we were photographed by Steve and myself for Interview magazine. And I'll just read this. This was there were a few pictures of club people, and it says, "Children of our times, children of the night, put no boundaries on themselves. They thrive to outdress, they live to outshock, they craft to outimpress. The children of the night are the life of the party. It is their life, their job. What would the kaleidoscope be without the children of the night?" George Wayne, photographed by Stephen Miser. I'm here with Nina, party and art. And here Nina again. And here we were at the Roxy Float at the New York City Pride. I was wearing this white feather thing, and Nina was doing her divine drag. And then in this picture, two young couples celebrating 4th of July. I was with Kenny Valenti, and this blonde on below is Amanda Lepore. I don't remember who was she with then, but Kenny used to live with Amanda, and so I got to know her even more than just in the club circles. And Kenny made dresses for Amanda, and many times they were see-through dresses, and Amanda was walking in the flat asking, "Does my pussy look good in this?" And we said, "Yes." And it's true. And here is Amanda with Jackie. And here is Amanda now. And here is me and Kenny later. And here is James St. James. And I covered him with green whipped cream. And here is from the Party Monster movie, Seth Green acting James St. James. This is some scene from some television talk show. And he says, "I'm not addicted to drugs, I'm addicted to glamour." Well, there were lots of drugs in New York, but I got out of New York before it got too dark and scary. And so the dark and scary part is what made the Party Monster movie. And me and Nico were part of the people who were hosting the London premiere and party in 2003. And here is another poster. And after New York, I went back to Finland, and this is where we live, by the river and near to nature, all nice and quiet.